I think I speak loud enough so everybody can hear me. And as you probably realized the minute I opened my mouth, that I was not born here. I was born in Germany. My family there on my mother's side goes back before Columbus discovered America. But when I was 7 years old, the political situation in Germany over here changed drastically. A group, the National Socialist Party, won the lead, won the ability to come along and govern an entire country. Country who espoused that they really didn't want to have anything to do with Jewish people. And as I said over here, my family dating back 600 years realized that their life in that country was going to have to come to an end. 5 years later, 1938, my folks were in a American consulate to ask some innocuous questions. They never got to ask them. The consulate people asked them a lot of questions. 3 hours. And then they were told, go home, you'll hear from us. And 3 days later, they got a letter that their application for a visa to come to this country had been accepted, not approved. And that started, in effect over here, the process where you're going to have to listen to me for a while. It did come, and I remember my folks were still able to come along and bring things with them. They had they put their entire bedroom in a 6x6 box, and which arrived with family history behind it. And we started in this country after a few weeks in a one room apartment, all five of us, my two brothers and my parents and myself. And then we moved to the last street in Manhattan, across from Bakersfield, and I got to learn about football. And at that particular time, Columbia University had a great team. They played against West Point, who had a great team at that particular time. Life in Manhattan was going to have to come to an end. And my parents, having, as I said, had an elegant women's fashion store, were advised to open up something like that out west. We went west, 16 miles to Newark, New Jersey. Never opened up a store. But I ended up taking a bus every day from the Clinton Hill section of Newark. Went to Down Neck, went to Eastside High School. And after 4 years, I graduated. and along with every member of every boy in my high school class, we went into services back then. When we came to this country, we were on a ship going through the hurricane of 1937, and believe me, I didn't want to have anything to do with water. So I ended up enlisted in the army and found myself in January of 1945 in Camp Wheeler, ready to come along and go back to Europe. And on my 19th birthday, I was told to get off a truck, one of 100 trucks with 2,500 other guys, and take my stuff off. And later on, I found out over here that my 8 buddies of mine who I trained with had gone into the Battle of the Bulge, and 3 of them were killed in action, and 5 were wounded. And I was not aware of that until much, much later, when one of the survivors of that had a newspaper stand on Market Street in Newark. And he had one of the most sought after jobs of every boy that we knew each other, because he spent his entire life while he was selling newspapers. Watching the girls go by. All I can tell you, I didn't make any money. Whatever money I made, I gave to my parents. And so my first date was when I was 23. And I called her up a week later, and her mother was on the phone. And I said to her, I would like to speak to her. You would like to speak to her? I forgot her name. Yes, I would like to speak to her. Well, I might get her, but can you tell me who you are? Are you her? On the other side, she said, you're not going to speak to her. And she banged on the phone. And as it turned out to be that I was invited by mutual friends on a blind date. They were living in Newark, on Elizabeth Avenue, near Elizabeth. And they saw to it that I was introduced to my future wife. And we ended up, a year and a half later, getting married. Had 3 kids, and spent a good life together. She passed away about 10 years ago, 10, 12 years ago. My job was drafted, I found myself being pulled out, I found myself in Munich at the end of the war, not having any assignment, until somebody came to me and he said, I understand you are fluent in German. And I said, yes. And he said, that office over there might be able to use you. And so the next day I went and I said, I'd like to volunteer. I understand you could use somebody who's fluent in German. And he said, fluent in art. And the man said, good, sit down in that chair. This guy next to you will tell you what to do. And it turned out to be the man that I spoke to with Jim Rommel, who was one of the leaders of what became known, what was known at that particular time at the Monuments, Fine Arts, and Archives section of the United States Army. And today is known as the Monuments Men. And I'm one of the last living Monuments Men here on this particular, here in this country. Contrary to what other countries have done, they have, in wars, and they have taken things or have destroyed it. This country, at World War II and afterwards, adopted a policy to save culture, to respect those that dealt with it, very uniquely in it. And as I said, there's only four of us still alive. Well, one very barely, and one who operated in Japan, and I wasn't sure about the one. So, but I'm the only one who really spent 15 months in that particular field. One of the things that that Jim Rohmer did, he, my patron, he took me with him in his travels through the American zone of occupation. I think they promoted him to a captain. And I remember one time, one of the two places that we visited was one of the called Eagle's Nest. That was a private place for Adolf Hitler. And the other place was Neuchâtel, which was a palace, a castle, that the King of Bavaria over here built fancy on it over here, and you probably see pictures of an American soldiers, and or let's say an officer directing the activities of three men carrying paintings over here. That was done in Alta, in Neuchâtel over here on it, and Jim Rohmer took me with him and introduced me to what was going, what he did. And he later on got me assigned to work in two salt mines, in which they had stored clean places, which the German institutions had stored 40,000 boxes of art that belonged to that particular one. Turned out to be 900 of which belonged to French institution, and I saw to it that we return. But when I Captain Rohmer took me in his jeep, and I was a private sitting in a passenger seat because I didn't know how to drive a car by that particular time. There was a group of officers and general, I think from the French one, a major general in the French army, and his representative asked Jim Rohmer that he understood that Jim Rohmer had the authority for him to go into Neuschwanstein. And Jim Rohmer let him know that under his leadership, the Major General and his staff would not go in there. And with that, he said, I got a company of American infantry making sure that you don't. And I never forget, with that, he drove the jeep. He, a lieutenant, and I, a buck private, went into Neuschwanstein when a Major General could not. Oh, I'm very proud of that. Because it was stored in that particular place. They stored, Hitler stored many works of art over here at that particular time. And today, I think it's still open. A beautiful view of the countryside, but forget about the art. That had been returned to the institution from which it came. One of the things that under his particular leadership, Jim Rohmer did, this is a building of the national headquarters, national headquarters of the Nazi Party during Hitler's time in Munich, this particular building. And Jim Rohmer made it his particular office, and that became the first collection point that he established. A collection point in which they gathered art that was realized did not belong to the institution in which it was found, but highly likely belonged to institutions in other countries. And that's where these particular paintings inside of it, instead of headquarters, that's where these works of art were collected, and representative came and provided the necessary basis to allow them to take it back to the institutions in their country from which it came. So it went to good use at that. And they had, Jim Rohmer established three collection points. One of them here in Munich, one of them in a German town of Wiesbaden, and a third one in the German town of Offenbach, in which they collected books and prints of importance over here. In other words, over here they concentrated on not works of art, but works over here that would be found in libraries over here. There was a man that I met about 5 years ago who mastered that particular one, who mastered that organization, spent his entire life in making sure that such works of culture over here was saved. Jim Rohmer got me assigned to work or ferret out works of art in two salt mines in southwest Germany, in a German town of Heilbronn and Kochendorf. And there, the German institution had stored 40,000 boxes of art to protect them from possible bombing of their particular museums and libraries over here in their particular cities, including the city in which I was born. They had a special interest was this particular painting of a Madonna. This belonged to a church in a small village in southern Germany, Stubach. And it was made by a painter in the 16th century, Grünewald. And Jim Rohmer, who had been brought up in the museum world, offered them $2 million, a humongous sum at that particular time. They turned it down. It's still there. So if you take a vacation in Southwest Germany and want to come along and see a famous painting, go to Stubach. But you don't have to bring any money with you. This is a picture of what the scene looked like 700 feet down in the chambers that contained the works of art like these. When I was assigned down there, they assigned some miners with them, and there was a hallway in which they had doors. And I asked, we came across this one door, and I said to what's in there? And the miners did not know. And I said to them, break it down. He said, we can't break it down. Break it down. And they broke down that particular door, and what we found is tables in which they had big glass jars of clear liquid with yellow bubbles coming out. And the miners went crazy. And I asked them, what's in there? They said, it's nitroglycerin. And that started me and the miners over here to, in conjunction with the management of this salt works, we got that glass jar safely out of there into the fields, and boom, instead of, if we hadn't found out over here, in 1 to 2 months, that thing would have gone off by itself over here and destroyed what was in that particular mine on it. So the attitude changed to this Jewish boy over here on it. There was a lieutenant who sort of was my boss man. I spent my time down in the mine over here doing the things, so we were equals. Well, he was individual who designed furniture in the Michigan city of Lansing over here on a particular one. And he spent most of his time having spent his earlier days in the army in Algiers, writing love letters to the daughter of the governor of Algiers. And all I can tell you is he permitted me to take him with him when he went to Paris to spend the week with her. I ended up spending a week in Paris. I had been there very briefly when we came to this country, but enlisted men were quartered in a department store, and I went. I got my bunk over here, went outside, and about less than a block away, I got approached by a woman who let it be known that I could spend my pleasure time with her. They had this place in the place in Paris where they had more women who helped other men than any other place in the world. And I got introduced to what you did with them. Because, as I said, I never had a date before that particular time. I couldn't afford it. This is a picture, a photograph. What we did do, Dale Ford, who was the lieutenant, what we did do, we made a report out, which is today, the copy of it is in the National Archives. And one of the pictures that we took of the stained glass windows from the Cathedral of Strasbourg, took a picture of it. These were two miners who reported to me, and we saw to it that that particular report got issued. Among the things that I brought with me is I got a set of photographs that that relate to my family. This was taken. I became a member of the Holocaust Committee of Metro West, and this particular was a picture of a panel that they had for exhibit of, I think about 10 years ago we started, of Holocaust survivors. So of greatest interest in the entire exhibit, if you ever would go to Greater Metro West in Whippany, they have a big hallway. They made an exhibit there, and of greatest interest in the entire exhibit, they had about 70 panels with this picture of me sitting on the lap of my father, and of the interest in that entire one was that I had a shirt on, an undershirt which reached my belly button, and nothing below, and the great interest of everybody was to see what my pecker looked like when I was 6 years old. Free of charge. Have anybody got any questions on the topic of us saving art unlike what was done before and unlike what was done afterwards, destroying it or taking it. Today, the ISIS is there over here. They have they have busted the buildings and the art over here that had existed in the Middle East for 2,000, 3,000 years. In minutes, they destroyed what was created during those particular centuries, and obviously cannot be repeated. As you realize that all of us have to appreciate the cultures that have made life a little bit better than what happened, what was happening in the centuries before this. We have to come along and appreciate. And obviously over here there are some people in the Middle East who don't realize that and are destroying instead of to save it. So I have, but I ask now over here if you have any questions. Maybe I can come along. Yes.
One thing that in the movie, The Monument Men, there was a problem with the Russians who also apparently were that you were, as I remember the movie, the Americans who were part of the group were saving, but then the Russians were coming and you were worried that they would destroy some of the patients too. Is that any reality or was just drama for the movie, if you remember? And is that, and one more question. You talked about all this art being given to institutions. Were there any private collections that then you found people who privately owned any of the art, or was that already not that period of time?
Well, generally over here, I dealt strictly with institutions. Mm-hmm. The Russians, they were subject to the Nazis taking some of their particular art, especially in St. Petersburg, on it. And they spent their particular time to take art and return it over here to the Russian institutions. As I said, if you go to St. Petersburg today over here, you'll find it. What was the other subject?
No, I just wanted to know whether there were any people at that time who were private, private. So you said no, you said that you then lost even with
Well, let me say this. A year after I got back, I got a notification from a German individual who accused me, and it came through when two FBI agents rang the door in on Clinton Avenue in Newark, where my folks lived and I lived with them, where they appeared at 9 o'clock in the morning, and it seemed that I was accused of stealing one of his paintings that he had stored in the salt mine. I was not aware of the artist. After they told me that, I ended up over here going I went to Newark College of Engineering and went down to class, and then I did some work over here on this particular artist, and found out over here that maybe presently his particular paintings might be worth $40. So I let it be known that with my ability, in when I worked in the two mines where they had works of art from institutions worth millions, I was not going to take a $40 one when I could take a $1 million one. I mean, you know, didn't make any sense over here on the particular one. But what happened, as I said, a year after I was discharged and on it. I was able to come along and during my time in service and spending my time there, I was able to come along and go to the place where my grandparents had last lived, and in a town which was not too far away from which I was brought up. Famous resort town of Baden-Baden. Oh, yes, you've all been there, you know, on it. That's where I met my first American. And I recognized them because all the women wore lipstick. And in Germany during those days, that was out, you know. I went there because I knew that my grandfather had his art collection there. And I went to the art collection, I went to that particular warehouse, and sure enough, they said they still have my grandfather's collection. So in celebration for me finding it, and I was going to make provisions for some of my buddies over here, my co-enlisted men, to return this thing, to return this work of art to me. I decided along with a representative, the personal valet of the governor of the French zone of occupation. He took us to a restaurant in the Black Forest, sea bass. And the one thing that they served there, besides the fish, which was outstanding, they served Kirschwasser, which is the same thing like scotch or vodka and gin or something like that over here, particularly. And with them, with me at that particular time, was a survivor of the Holocaust, who became a lifelong friend of mine. His name was Ike. That's what we called him. And Ike liked Kirschwasser. And so, in celebration for me finding my grandfather's collection of art, Ike had not only one glass of Kirschwasser, but he had another glass of Kirschwasser, and a third glass of Kirschwasser, and then one more glass of Kirschwasser. And he, on the way back to go back from Baden-Baden to where I was stationed, Heilbronn, we had to go through the Black Forest, which was hilly, mountainous, and we came across a 180-degree bend in the road, in which on the one side they had a drawer lined with Belgian blocks to take the water that were falling from the mountains above it to the side so it wouldn't go on the on the road itself. And as we were driving, and with Eich driving the car, that he drove the wheels into that trough and it got stuck. And it took 10 men to pull this thing out. And once having pulled out, we found out over here that the Jeep no more had no more brakes. And it was unanimously decided by the three of us, Eich, Jacques, the French valet, and myself, we're going to coast down back to Baden-Baden. And as you realize, we made it. But the problem was, where were these two Americans going to stay that night? One, a buck private who hadn't told his sergeant that he was going to take a trip to to Baden-Baden and was now AWOLF without leave, punishable by things, and a Holocaust survivor who did the thing over here, and where we were going to come along and stay. And as we went back, Jacques, the French valet, he contacted his, he knew his lady friend was head of housekeeping in the top hotel in Baden-Baden. And that night, the two of us, Eich and me, we slept in a bed that was really reserved solely for the Kaiser and Kaiserin of Deutschland. And I'll never forget it. Yeah. Any other questions? Yes.
How did you learn about art? I mean, you're doing this work, and how did you know what was what and so forth? How much knowledge do you have about art?
Well, my I think I mentioned my grandfather. We were, my family was interested in art, not music. And my grandfather was a collector of art, primarily, it ended up over here, he had 1,000 of them, works of prints that people would put inside the hardcover of the book to identify where they came from. In other words, affluent people had libraries, and they had works of art inside each one of the book, that this was a part of the ex libris of Otto Oppenheimer. In other words, out of the library of Otto Oppenheimer, the artist made a big deal. And I have a collection of these works of art that fitted inside the one. Among the 1,000 prints that are sitting in one of my closets. So if anybody wants one, $25. Anybody else? Yes.
What percentage of the artwork that was discovered has been returned to its original owners?
I don't think anybody had, but the consensus of the monuments men at that particular time, that there were probably 500,000 works of art that were of real value that were no longer in the hand of the original owner. And when whether they had been found, unlikely it will take generations to get back. I will tell you this, that as I said, I once took a vacation to find myself in Massachusetts when I heard that a lady in a museum in Connecticut, Bush Museum. Her name was
Adele.
What?
Adele
Altman.
Yes.
Yeah. She was the lady in a painting by a artist by the name of Klimt. Klimt over here was a artist, an impressionist, who never really came out over here when the impressionists were there, but later his particular paintings were, and there was this one painting of a lady by him that was found in, I think, on near Fifth Avenue in New York, that was made by him of her, Altman over here on it. And I met her one time over here. She had two doors and she was looking for that particular painting. You got $140 million? It might be for sale. Yes.
Sir, did they ever have an amount that they, Hitler's nest, you know, when we opened up, did they ever find out how much that the antiques that he had in that whole section there?
Well, believe it or not, when on the 1st of May, 1945, which was the week before World War II officially ended in Europe, I found myself in Munich, having come from, at that, from Belgium, France over here, and found myself there. And all I know is that they had a, in the place where I was sitting, they had a lot of drugs. And it turned out to be the drugs had art in them from a, that was taken from a mine in Austria, Altalsee. And that was Hitler's collection of 6,600 paintings that he had collected there. And the reason why there were so much activities, because the Russians, unlike the movie where it showed them to be 20 minutes behind, were 2 weeks behind. and we realized we had to come along and get those particular paintings out. And obviously they ended up in the collection point that I showed you, you know. They were not, we did not know who the rightful owner was. And they're probably, as I mentioned to somebody before, probably about 500,000 valuable works of art that are no longer in the hands of the owner at the start of World War II. Yes? Could you stand up, please?
How much consulting, did they consult with you for the movie? Did you have anything to do with the movie?
No, but they knew my entire story.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
But the author must have interviewed.
What? Robert Etzel.
Yeah.
Well, I have been in touch with him over here, you know. Well, unfortunately, he has at the present time financial problems.
I heard he was working on a new book.
What?
I heard he was working on a new book.
Yeah, but he has, regrettably, people who have the financial means haven't come across with the money.
Because I thought it had something to do with Italy.
What?
His second book is supposed to be about retrieving art in Italy.
Well, there's, one of the three books that published, one of the three books is Saving Italy. And that's available up there, besides the Monuments Men. And a third one is Rescuing Da Vinci. That really tells the entire story of what the Monuments Men have done.
That hasn't been published yet.
What?
That hasn't been published
yet. That has been published. But I'm not sure of, I think it had limited output over here on it. I have a copy of that. So if you want to borrow it for about 2 weeks, come and see me. How much?
To borrow your book.
$26. Yes.
Were you able to find records or documentation of all this art that helped you find its original owners? Or was it kind of a
monster? The ones over here that I dealt with institutions, mm-hmm. not private individuals, you know. Yes, there was one case of a private individual who... did I mention over here that I was approached by two FBI agents?
Yes.
Yeah. That was my only contact when somebody accused me. I made sure that my grandfather's collection was sent to this country because he ended up he and my grandfather ended up over here with my first cousin and on it. And I have part of his collection today, it's still, you know, because I'm not in the art field over here on it. And some of them are hanging on my wall, you know. I put, frames around them, especially the one over here that's in my kitchen. I had a some material that would fit on over the picture, and I ended up finding a painting that would fit behind it, and then I found that somebody would come along and put a frame on it, and I found that if I put it on the wall where in my kitchen, in my where I have, you know, I have breakfast and something, half the wall is empty. So I found another painting, and it now has the same frame and everything else like that. And it's, I'm told I have a well-decorated place. Yeah, including a print of the self-portrait of Rembrandt. That from an agency told me maybe it's worth $300, you know, not for sale. Yes.
Besides the works of art, sculpture, and painting, were any religious artifacts saved in these mines, like Torah scrolls, things from synagogues, or a stained glass window?
I did come in the mines in which I worked. There was no Judaica in there, but it did come across when I, before I joined over here, I did come across places where they did have Judaica, you know, Torahs and things of that particular nature, but not in the two mines in which one of the things over here that it did have that I don't think I talked about is that fireworks. I found fireworks in one of the mines in Heilbronn to celebrate Hitler's victory. And I decided, here's a Jewish kid, on the 4th of July, 1946, decided that in lieu of celebrating Hitler's victory, we should celebrate our victory. So that on the 4th of July, 1946, there was, with the help of German salt mine workers, we had 35 minutes of fireworks in the city of Heilbronn. I'm damn proud of it. Anybody else? Yes.
Was there other stuff in the salt mines besides art, or other things stashed away, vehicles or planes?
In those two mines, besides some personal belongings, and besides the thing, I don't remember anything. And besides the fireworks, I don't remember anything else over here which was hidden in that particular one. All I can tell you is that probably about 3 or 4 years later, the mine came to an end. They had gotten enough of the stuff to bring it to an end, and they about 4 or 5 years ago, when I went there, they were filling it up. They were filling up the empty spaces to it. Remember over here that about 250 million years ago, Europe was effectively an ocean. And when it went, the heat evaporated the water, what was left is 100 feet, 150 feet of salt. 80% of salt, and the rest of it was rock, which they went down and mined. In most of the places all over the world, instead of going down there today over here, they bring, I think, cold or hot water over here, melt it and suck it up, suck up the salty water over here, and then condense it over here on a particular one. All I remember, one of the things that I remember is that in the place where they mined, where that particular one, they had an industrial complex above it. And what they did, they took that rock with the salt and heated it up to 1200 degrees Fahrenheit to separate the salt from the rock. And then they came along and had a vat that they rotated, and it became salt, and they put it into glass jars. In order to do that, they needed some coal, and they produced coke instead of coal, some artificial coke over here, which they made there in order to heat up the oven that provided over here that refined the salt. And they had excess capacity in that particular one, in which they had another part of the industrial complex made glass bottles. That's what they produce, glass bottles. And 3 months after World War II finished, they ended up putting something in those glass bottles. The first industrial product in Germany that was produced. Coca-Cola. That's what they made in Heilbronn over here. Well, thank you very much over here for allowing me to talk to you tonight.